How do you go about getting an exorcism?
You're convinced that it's genuine?
Your daughter doesn't say she's a demon. She says she's the devil himself.
I think every one of the films I've made, they've all found me. I've never gone out looking to make a film. I was doing a press tour just before the opening of The French Connection, and I received a package from William Peter Blatty. I opened it, and there is the manuscript of The Exorcist. And I started to read it, and I read the whole thing that night. And so I called Blatty, and he told me that it was based on a true story, that his novel had just appeared, and he had sold the rights to Warner Brothers, and he wanted to know if I'd be interested in directing it. And I said, absolutely. I would absolutely love to do this.
Billy Friedkin, I had heard that he was a prize-winning documentary filmmaker. That's what I want. This story is so wild for the greater public. It needs that documentary, grainy film feeling about it.
I shot it almost like a documentary. It's very simply shot, it's very clear, and it's done by a writer and a director, myself and Bill Blatty, who were able to infuse into the cast and the crew a belief in the material.
The beginning of the film, I went to Billy and I said, you know, this is something special. I said, if you don't mind, I'd like to shoot some behind-the-scenes footage of it. And he said, oh, don't worry about it. He said, Warner Brothers will send a team in and they'll be doing it. I said, okay, fine. And then one day in Georgetown, on location there, the crew showed up. And it sure didn't work too well. And with that, I called a friend of mine who had a camera rental company in New York and got the camera and got the film, and we just started shooting from that day on. I made sure that we stayed in the background. I didn't get sound because I knew if we had somebody walking around with a boom pole with a mic on it and Billy was aware of it that much, he probably would shut it down. This way, we sort of like a little unit within a unit there. It's time now to show them how we did some of this, because it is a great classic film. And some of it was a lot of hard work, and Billy did an amazing job, and he was very demanding, and he drew the best out of everybody.
I think it's wonderful if we can do a reveal, that what you see is what the camera saw then, right then.
What I think people will get out of it when they see things like how the objects flew across the room, simple thing like that, and they go, wow, that's a simple solution to something like that. And at the time, I remember what we were thinking, how is this going to play? I mean, but to see it, and it brings back such fond memories. Linda was just this cute, sweet, little innocent girl, 13, 14 years old. And then to see her transform, and what the amazing part she did with it, to see that and see what she was like behind the scenes, just a young girl, just having a milkshake on the set, things like that. That to me is just so nice to see, especially after all these years.
The makeup was difficult for me. Dick Smith, his biggest problem was taking such a gentle child's face that was round. How do I make this evil without it being a mask? Billy's vision was that people would recognize me, and that was important, and everything got to be so minimal so that you would recognize. It was more about scars and evil and the painting. But it was very, very difficult, very disciplined, and a lot of work, and everything was very choreographed, very set, so that it could flow like butter with the actual filming.
We when you see how Max von Sydow is transformed from a young man into the Exorcist, it's amazing.
My mother used to talk about at the end of the day when Max would take his makeup off and be going down the hall and be all young and dapper and stuff with his blazer that they wore back then. And you didn't know it was the same person. But that's an actor's dream, is to play all different ages. And he had his own relationship with Billy Friedkin, which I got to watch, but it was very more disciplined in certain ways, I think.
I will tell you about what I believe is the sole cause of all those stories you heard about people getting nauseous, people fainting, people screaming, running out of the theater, all that. It was not any of the horror that was taking place. It was, in fact, the medical science that was taking place.
The arteriogram, which took place at New York University Medical Center with an actual radiologist and his assistant.
Those scenes where they have all the tubes coming out and so on and so forth, that really, really gets to people.
When we went to the hospital, it was actually very easy to shoot. And the reason was I used basically the lighting that was in the rooms because it was the way it looked, and I didn't want to alter that.
I saw the first press preview, and up the aisle from the front comes a woman holding her hand to her forehead, and I hear her saying, "Jesus, Jesus, Jesus." But what grossed her, shocked her, made her almost faint? The arteriogram. Anytime I am more or less forced to watch the entire film, and I know that needle is going here and blood's going to go, I look down, I look away. Oh, it's horrid. The horror that medical science is putting her through, far worse than the demon.
I'm speaking to the person inside of Reagan now.
In the scene with the shrink, where Linda grabs him and he falls backwards, Billy wanted to have a shot going all the way down with his face right to the floor. And so we had to figure out a way to shoot that. So we had to come up with a rig. I wish I could take credit for inventing the rig, but it was the grips that did it. I mean, we explained what the problem was, and they figured out how to do it. And so they built this great contraption where we had the actor leaning against this thing, and he's in the rig, and the camera's on one side of the rig, mounted exact distance away from his face, and stays that same distance, and then they just tilt the whole thing over together.
That's master filmmaking, that's Billy Friedkin, that's Owen Roizman's work. And he talked to me about lenses. I talked to him about why there are different feels. And he explains, well, if you do this or you do that, you can bring in this, and there's your intimacy. And I was like, wow, didn't know. Because I mean, I was very curious myself. So those are all your masters.
Dr. Klein.
Yes, I'm Dr. Klein. This is Dr. Taylor.
And then we had to do a shot where we go from the first floor to the second floor, really, in one shot. And nowadays, you'd use a Steadicam, and it would be nothing. It would be an easy shot. But we didn't have a Steadicam then. So we built this chair rig where we could mount the camera in a chair. We suspended it from wires, and this intricate cable system that could move side to side, forward and back. And the grips would be up above, and they actually controlled the chair from up above and pulled it up and slid it around in a circle. Lighting it was tricky because with all that equipment, you see shadows all over the place with wires and rigs and things like that. So I had to light it so it was shadowless completely from the first floor to the second floor. That was a challenge in itself.
Mother, please! Oh, please, Mother, make it stop!
Why this girl?
doesn't make sense.
I think a lot of people may not realize what Billy probably had to go through as well. He had to not only create and have everything and all his homework ready, but he had to be careful of how he was and or anybody in the presence of a minor.
Keep away! The sow is mine!
He would hand me the dialogue and I'd read it and I'd be like,
oh. Fuck me!
Fuck me!
A child does not know what those words mean.
Fuck me!
But he probably really did have to think about how was he going to get that performance. He never ever once tried to do something to intentionally hurt me or to misguide me.
You know what she did? Your canting daughter!
Linda Blair was just a jewel. Boy, she'd be on that set for endless hours. She never complained.
I became a kind of surrogate father to Linda. I would very often kid her into doing something. I would say to her, now, you're going to have to take this crucifix and you're going to have to pretend that you are thrusting it between your legs. And she would say, oh, no, like a little girl. She was 12 years old. She'd say, oh, no, I'm not going to do that. And I'd say, oh, yes, you are. Oh, yeah, come on. And I would kid her into it. I'd start tickling her, making her laugh. I think it was her affection for me that allowed her to do things that had probably never been asked of a child, and certainly not in a movie. It was about mutual trust.
When I was writing the novel, I had come to a point where I had to ask myself, how am I going to get this aggressively, militantly atheistic mother to take her child to a priest? And I said, what is the most horrific thing that Satan would do, which would cause the mother to go to priests?
Did you put this in Reagan's bedroom?
And it hit me almost immediately. It was that masturbation with the crucifix. Of course, in the book, I didn't worry about anything. Nobody was going to see anything. Their own mind would supply whatever they saw. But for the film, I thought Billy did it tremendously.
Fuck Jesus, fuck you! Fuck Jesus, fuck you!
I remember the rig we built to put the camera up above her, and I remember her giggling and laughing and joking around with us as we were setting it up and doing it. It was almost like she didn't understand the scene. That's, you know, I figured she's a young girl. I don't know if she even knows what she's doing here. Does this register?
I simply did what I was told to do. Billy Friedkin absolutely directed every single bit of my performance.
It was a very light attitude on the set that day. It wasn't anything serious. Nobody said walk around on tiptoes or anything like that. Billy kept the set light. We all were joking and kidding around and things. And Linda was just having a good time. It was almost like she was playing a game.
Lick me! Lick me!
A child does not know what masturbation is. A child does not understand a lot of sexual conduct. With that said, now that people are going to finally be privy to understand how it was done and realize, no, I had no idea what it meant. I didn't understand. It is all mechanical. Again, that would prove the point of how I say Billy Friedkin orchestrated and directed everything.
The amazing part about Linda was when Billy would say action with something like that, all of a sudden she would go from that little girl to that serious actress. And that was the amazing part.
I was raised Protestant. We didn't talk about the devil. So the devil was fictitious to me. It was the same thing as the Wolfman, as any of the monster films. It did not exist. And that's what Billy found, was that innocence. I didn't know what the devil was. If I'd grown up Catholic, I don't think you could have cast a Catholic child in the part.
Ah! Ah!
when I set out to create the illusion of all this stuff happening, I had no idea whether it would ever work or whether an audience would laugh. And on many occasions, an audience would laugh at some of the most extreme effects because laughter is a reaction to something that you can't really let in or tolerate. Very often, an audience reaction is, you know, that doesn't really bother me. I could laugh that off.
What is it?
I think the vomit has such power because it comes as such a surprise. Why would anybody think that all of a sudden this green bile would come out of this person? And it's the most disgusting thing you can do. People don't like to be spit on, let alone vomited on in such a way. And of course, it's the devil's way of really trying to degrade both priests.
When you see the vomit come out of Linda's mouth, we had to know exactly where it was going to go. So we took a piece of cardboard and put it up and used it as a target and practiced on that to see exactly where it would be. So when Jason Miller was in there, we'd know what to do with it. It was a very tricky scene to shoot because we had to have all these devices installed in her mouth. And so we had Eileen Dietz, who was a performer, come in, and we set her up, and we did rehearsals with her and lined up the shots, and we even shot a few takes with her just so we'd have the footage. I don't remember why, but I filmed mainly behind-the-scenes footage of Eileen Dietz getting into makeup and getting all the tubes put in through her mouth. But finally, when we were ready to shoot, Linda came in, and we made the shots mostly with her. In the final cut, there's a subliminal cut of Eileen that we had made. But basically, it's Linda.
The whole time, of course, I have to keep my mouth open because once the equipment is laid on and put in, and it goes in my mouth and comes back out, and you cannot close your mouth because if you close your teeth, it'll backfire in my throat. It was really, really hard.
When I saw the dailies, it seemed to go on interminably. And I said, you know, it makes me queasy looking at vomit, even though we know it's pea soup and oatmeal. But Billy used it so effectively.
Vladdy begins his novel in northern Iraq, and the final sequence ends in a tiny little bedroom that's about as big as the studio we're in now. The other thing that made Blatty's story so believable was that it takes place in a room which is like a prison, where there's no way to get out, no way to get out alive.
Billy was meticulous about the ritual. He had two Jesuit priests on the site, making sure that everything was done absolutely properly. He had respect for the material, for Catholicism, you know, for religion. And it showed through all his work.
Just shooting the exorcism in general was difficult. It was very time consuming because on a technical level, we had to run the air conditioners while we were setting up and preparing. The only reason we wanted the room to be cold was because we had to see the breath. And the catch-22 there is we had to refrigerate the room with air conditioners in order to see the breath. Well, you see the breath usually with moist cold, and air conditioners take the moisture out of the cold also. Because it was dehumidifying at the same time, we had to get it to like 20 below zero before you'd even see the breath.
Be silent!
And the actors would come in and to perform in this. And they only have a short window to perform because once they start, the room would warm up pretty quickly. And we'd have to then chill it, you know, everybody go out and then have to cool it down again. So it was a long, tedious process to get that done. It's such a tribute to them as artists and actors that they could just turn it on and turn it off and get into it.
The men all had their the old ski suits that look a lot like kind of like a space uniform, you know, and they're walking around kind of like that. And me, I got, you know, long underwear and a nightgown. Lucky me.
Please do to make in your image.
If I was doing the same scene today, we wouldn't even have to do it like that because we do it all in computer graphics.
There were no computer-generated images in which you could portray the special effects of The Exorcist. They all had to be done mechanically. And so when the two priests are reciting the liturgy and they see Linda's body levitate, they're seeing that right in front of them. We had to create everything mechanically on camera, and the actors could see that.
What an excellent day for an exorcism.
And it was pretty frightening to look at. And you could get the idea in the scene of what the audience was seeing. And so, yes, the low-tech aspect of the film did help the film at that time.
I cast you out!
Fortunately, I had some good training in my commercial days, and it just so happens that some of the things we did in commercials were fly people, and we flew them on wires. And so I had this little stuff in my bag of tricks now, and I was able to call on it. And so I would have the set painter paint the wires with dotted lines. When you look at a dotted line, you're not going to see it that clearly, because anything that's dark against light, you'll see. Anything light against dark, you'll see. But when it's broken up with light, dark, light, dark, light, dark, you can get away with a lot with the background. I had lit it so that the background had shadows on it. And now with the painting, the scenic artist went out and hand-painted each wire. And when I saw it blend into the background, I knew it was right.
The power of Christ compels you!
I went along with the fact that the head spun, and obviously we all know it's not real. That just proves a lot of people wanted to buy into amazing filmmaking.
Everybody over the years always asks, how did she turn her head around? Well, here you're able to see it. It's fun to see that. And I remember doing it when we were working on it, how everybody was involved with, like, opening this dummy's head up and the wires and being able to move the eyes and the mouth and all the different things independently. I mean, Marcel Verka, too, the special effects man, and Dick, the makeup artist, just did an incredible job with everything.
The dummy sat up in the makeup room, so I'm constantly looking over at my face. I didn't enjoy the experience of being in its presence, let's say.
Of our Lord Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with the Father.
We were all set to shoot the scene when she does the 360 degrees, and I said, I think we missed one thing, guys. And what's that? I said, breath. You can't see any breath. And Marcel went, oh my God, he's right, you know? And so Marcel Verka, too, the special effects man, he found a way to do it, and quickly. And so we were able to shoot the scene. But things like that, it was such a collaborative effort there, too. And it's nice to show that collaborative effort, just to show how everything was done. You see that bed rocking, and to see how that works, and all the prop men that were back there just cranking away on a simple mechanical thing to make this supernatural thing happen.
Amen.
I said, Billy, we got to cut this. The 360 degrees won't go. I was so wrong. I mean, that is iconic. That shot. The audience went goo-goo over that. They screamed. I still don't know why. I don't know. Maybe it's because so shockingly unexpected.
I think no matter how hard through the years I've tried to tell people, I really don't think they'll ever understand the process and what it took to get to the character. Everything that I had to withstand and then act. I cannot wear contacts. So they had to put numbing drops in. So every day I had numbing drops, and then the contacts were put in. The white one took over the whole eye. We're new. They were actually more comfortable. Couldn't see anything. Yeah, and I don't think anybody's ever understood how hard it was for my end.
God himself commands you.
Is she gonna die?
You are tremendously engaged with the characters in The Exorcist. That helps it to work very well, but moreover, the pace of development is a slow one. It builds and it builds before anything really apparently paranormal occurs, with the most horrific, you know, save for the end.
Son of a bitch!
Ray Bradbury once wrote that it's actually a beautiful love story.
God damn you! Take me! Take me!
Here's a priest who gives his own life voluntarily to save the life of a little girl he's never met. He never met Regan McNeil. Only the demon.
It wasn't until I saw the film later on that I truly was stunned. They did an opening in New York. All these people are gathered, you know, like a big party of thing, you know. I'm sitting probably midsection, and what I knew as the movie closed was that I had just been part of something that would change my life forever. I knew that. I didn't know how and why, but I knew that. And then they gave me a standing ovation, and that, it meant a lot. I didn't know why.
Telling you that that thing upstairs isn't my daughter.
I know that it is considered by a great many people as a horror film. I've never thought of it that way, and I didn't approach it that way. It's a story about the mystery of faith.
I'm afraid.
It's a theological thriller, and I always tell young people this is not a horror film. Anybody that thinks this is a horror film is wrong.
I want you to tell me that you know for a fact that there's nothing wrong with my daughter except in her mind.
I saw it as a supernatural detective story in which paranormal phenomena were occurring, which in fact reportedly do occur in real life. I cringe when I hear horror applied to it. It destroyed my comedy writing career, needless to say.
My mom always said before she died, she said, to play Jesus Christ or to play the devil will change your life forever. And she's right.
You're gonna die up there.
I tried really hard to let people know it was just a movie, that it took a lot, and now people can see what I endured. That I was proud to become an actor. It's a great gift to be able to be part of the art form.
Mother, what's wrong with me?
The Exorcist gives you one possible explanation of why bad things happen to good people. It's that simple. It also says there is a very thin line between good and evil, which is in all of us.
Where's Regan?
In here with us.
And this novel, Blatty's screenplay, our film, tells you that.
Woman, get down!
Can't you help her? Just help her! You tell me you know for a fact that an exorcism wouldn't do any good! You tell me that! Is it over?
No.
Give us time!
Let her die!